I knew I sinned this day, just like you said you would. Your word is not in vain, our hearts reaching heavenward. Unleash a fresh outpouring. We need a fresh outpouring. Unleash a fresh outpouring. Fresh outpouring, tear the fabric open. Come, Jesus, come.
When I night has fallen, when fear is coming, still you're calling me. When faith is lost and my hope exhausted, you will be my strength. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. Yeah, I've decided I'm not giving up, 'cause you won't give up on me. You won't give up on me. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out like an echo. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. Nah. I feel it breaking out like an echo, echo in my soul. Oh, soul. Oh. In every season, you keep repeating promises to me.
Good morning and welcome to Southgate Church. We're so glad that you joined us this morning. I just encourage you to engage in the online chat. Tell us who you are and where you're watching from. Also, throughout the service, you'll see different prompts come up on your screen, whether it's connect, give, or more options. And lastly, as a church, one of our core values is worship God. And we really believe in the importance and the practice of putting God first in our lives. So I just encourage you guys to open your hearts up, put away any distractions, and just spend some time intentionally worshiping God and allowing Him to minister to you this morning. Thanks for joining us.
Death had claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood. One final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake
and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared? Oh, hail King Jesus. Oh, hail the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, hail King Jesus.
Good morning and welcome to Southgate Church. We're so glad that you joined us this morning. I just encourage you to engage in the online chat. Tell us who you are and where you're watching from. Also, throughout the service, you'll see different prompts come up on your screen, whether it's connect, give, or more options. And lastly, as a church, one of our core values is worship God. And we really believe in the importance and the practice of putting God first in our lives. So I just encourage you guys to open your hearts up, put away any distractions, and just spend some time intentionally worshiping God and allowing Him to minister to you this morning. Thanks for joining us.
Happy New Year. Welcome to Southgate Church 2021. We are excited for this coming up year. Last year was an interesting one, and so we have faith to believe that this is going to be even better than last year, which doesn't require a lot of faith to say, but we're believing it's going to be great. Anyways, welcome to the service this morning. We are excited that you're joining with us. I want to encourage you to join with us. Wherever it is that you're watching, that you would participate and not just watch. Maybe that means standing up. Maybe it means raising your hands as we're singing. Maybe it means just sitting where you are and singing along. Whatever that looks like, I want to encourage you to engage with us. Let me open up in a word of prayer, and then we're going to get into worship. Father, we thank you this morning that we can say with confidence that you are the King of Kings, that you are the Lord of Lords. Father, I thank you that we can come and gather in our various locations, wherever it may be, and we're together. I thank you that your Holy Spirit is present in all of the places. And God, we just desire this morning that you would find pleasure in our worship. And so, God, I just welcome you to wherever it is that we are. God, that you would make yourself known to us. We worship you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Start off this new year singing, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. helper. We welcome you into our homes, in our lives. Let's sing.
Unshakable, hallelujah, you
Church, the King is alive. Amen.
just as we've been singing that song, there was a phrase that stuck out to me and reminded me of a passage of scripture, and it says, in the middle of the storm. And I was reminded of the story in the New Testament of when the disciples were in a boat and the storm rose up on the waters and they began to freak out. They began to panic. They began to go to a place in their minds where they thought that the world was going to end and they were going to drown. And they ran to find Jesus, who was in the boat with them, and he was sleeping. And he woke up and he spoke to the storm and it calmed down. And the last little bit here, as I've been preparing for 2021, I've had time to think, and there's been a passage of scripture that has continually been ringing in my mind, in my heart, and it's one that we're familiar with. It's Proverbs 3, and I want to read it for us out of the Passion Translation. But verse 5, it says, trust in the Lord completely. Do not rely on your own opinions. Just again, the story of the disciples. They were relying on their opinion that life was going to end for them. It goes on to say, with all your heart, rely on him to guide you, and he will lead you in every decision you make. Verse 6, become intimate with him in whatever you do, and he will lead you wherever you go. Don't think for a moment that you know it all, for wisdom comes when you adore him with undivided devotion. And avoid everything that's wrong. Verse 8, and then you will find the healing refreshment your body and spirit longs for. For me, that brings such an encouragement. And I'm going to hold on to this passage for this year, that I would not rely on my opinion, but that I would pursue him, that I would trust in him, that I would allow his voice to lead me, that when I find myself in the middle of the storm, that I would go to him and I would hear his voice say to me, it's going to be all right. Maybe you're finding yourself in a storm already. 2021 started off a bit rough for you. Let me encourage you that you turn your attention to him, that you go find him, for he is near. And so we're going to take a moment this morning, and we're going to pray for people within our family, within our community here at Southgate Church. There are needs that are being put up on the screen right now. People need healing. They need physical healing in their bodies, battling cancer. There are people who are suffering in relationships, and we want to pray for them. There are people who are without work. We're going to pray for them. And so wherever you are, would you join with me? And maybe you are this morning or afternoon or evening, whenever it is that you're watching, in a place where you want prayer. I want to encourage you right where you're at, just even to put your hand up, just as an acknowledgement. God, here I am. I need prayer. And as I pray, I just believe that the Spirit of God is going to do a work in your situation. Would you join me this morning in prayer? Father, I just thank you that you are faithful. I thank you that you are present, that you are with us at this very moment. Wherever it is that we are, you are with us. I thank you that your word tells us that we can call out and you hear us. You hear our cries. You tell us in scripture that we can ask in the name of Jesus and it will be done. And so as we take time to pray, we pray in the name of Jesus. We pray for those that need a physical touch in their bodies, healing. We declare in Jesus' name. We know that Jesus, you are greater, that your name is above the name cancer. And so we declare the name of Jesus, not as a magic word, but in the authority that it carries. We pray for those that find themselves in relational difficulties. Maybe it's between spouses or children. Maybe it's at work or at school. God, I ask that you would bring reconciliation into these relationships. God, I ask that there would be humility to admit when there is wrongs and faults, that there would be humility to ask for forgiveness and that it would be extended. God, I pray and ask in the name of Jesus that these relationships would be mended. Father, we pray for those that find themselves in the midst of challenging times financially. God, I just ask that you would just do a miracle. Your word says that you know our needs and that you will provide. And so, Father, I pray that you provide for the needs of those that find themselves in places of difficulty financially. God, we pray that there would be open doors for employment in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that even members of Southgate Church would have it put on their heart to give to those that are in need, just to bless them. Father, I thank you that we can bring all these things to you. We just lay them at your feet. We release them now. No longer do we need to carry the struggles, the stresses, the frustrations, but we just give it to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, you're going to hear it in just a minute as we watch church news, but we are beginning this year off with prayer, daily prayer. And I want to invite you to join with us as we gather together as a church on Zoom for our nights of prayer. These have always been powerful times as a church. And I want to encourage you to not just wait until the evening to pray on Zoom, but to pray throughout the day. Begin this year off in an attitude and in a heart of prayer. And we do have a special guest that's going to be joining us, but I'm going to leave that for church news to tell you who it is. But as we prepare for church news, I just want to call us to a place of giving again, of generosity. First off, I want to thank you for your generosity in 2020. It's been a challenging year, we know that. But yet, Southgate Church has been so generous. We've been able to bless our community in ways that a year ago we wouldn't have even thought that we would be doing. And many, many, many needs were met, and it's really because of the generosity of all of you. And so thank you for that. But I want to read for us again out of Proverbs 3. It's verse 9. I stopped at verse 8. But verse 9 says this. It says, glorify God with all your wealth, honoring him with the very best, with every increase that comes to you. Then every dimension of your life will overflow with blessings from an uncontainable source of inner joy. How many of you want that inner joy? I sure do. And so, church, let's continue being generous. Let's continue to honor God with all that we have. And let's be amazed at what God is going to do with our gifts. You can see on the screen all the ways to give. I want to encourage you to make this a priority for this year. Amen. Let's enjoy church news.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year, Southgate Church. This year is bound to be better than last year, and we're starting off this year with all church prayer every night, starting tonight, January 3rd, 7:30. You'll see the Zoom link on our emails and stuff, and every night this week, we're gonna be praying for our community, praying for one another, and praying for the church. And just also want to let you know that Charlie Sweet is going to be joining us, and we're looking forward to that, to actually start this year with a prophetic word into the church. So join us in prayer.
Settle down, kids. Settle down. We have a lot of good things happening coming up. Don't forget to follow us on our social media sites, Facebook, Instagram. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel, and those emails. Make sure you sign up to get those weekly emails. The best is yet to come.
Happy New Year, church.
Debbie, look excited.
Woohoo! Yeah. Get your blower. No, I
don't. Well, good morning, Southgate Church, and Happy New Year. I was just thinking, as we were moving this way, 2021 has got to be better than 2020.
And we often say the phrase, the best is yet to come, and that's almost not that difficult after this last year that we've had. And 2021, kind of an amazing number. I remember back to 1968 when a movie came out called Space Odyssey 2001. And in 1968, we're thinking, 2001? That's like, is that ever going to happen? And now here we are, 2021, which is pretty amazing. When that movie came out, there was no personal computers, there was no cell phones, and none of that kind of stuff. And, you know, in 20 years later, 30 years later, we had cell phones and smartphones, and like, it's pretty crazy what's taken place. Just before I start this morning, I do want to say how grateful I am for our online team these last 10 months. I think of some of the ones that have been so faithfully committed. You know, I think of Chris Krause, who has been at every service and done the recording for all of the services. Randy's been out now the last little while doing all of the PowerPoints and looking after all that stuff, and then Malin and the worship team. I am so grateful. And Joe Witness, probably he's been at every single service, and then he spends the hours recording and editing everything, and I'm sure that he has become super spiritual because he's seen so many messages over and over again. But I am very grateful to our online team. I want to talk. Here we are, 2021, and I thought of New Year's resolutions. We often don't use that anymore, but I remember as a kid growing up, that was the thing. When New Year came, you know, we'd have the big celebration on New Year's Eve, and then the next day I was always talking about what are the resolutions. And I actually think when I was a kid, we had to write down some things that we were going to do. And I remember 2 or 3 years ago as a church, we did a weight loss competition, and we did different things. It was the machine called the Bod Pod, and for 3 months everybody was exercising and dieting, and then, you know, we had a winner at the end. And I actually think the winner was my wife, if I remember. But I just thought, okay, 3 months, man, we worked at it. And then after 3 months, I'd like to ask you, if you were in that competition, how did it go after that? Did you keep up with it? I think of myself, a couple of years ago, started a really good rhythm of going to the gym. And, you know, 3-4 days a week, I was going to the gym. Once in a while, I would be with a trainer. And I felt like I was doing really good. And then COVID hit, everything was shut down, and I lost my rhythm. I just, it's been hard. I haven't been able to really get back into that rhythm. So I'm working at it. And, you know, I know some people, no sugar. So you go into 2021, I'm not going to have any sugar. My question always is, how long is that going to last? I have sat through so many conversations about dieting, what I'm going to eat, what I'm going to do. And then people go into it and dive into it, and they're doing it. And then, I don't know, things change, or somebody offers them a chocolate and boom, it's gone. And so, you know, I think of all of the resolutions, and yet we're stepping into a series this new year that I feel is so relevant and pertinent to where we are as individuals, but I think also for us as a church. And we're calling the series Rhythms of Grace. And I put a tagline on it, sharpening your focus, or adjusting your focus. Last month, just before Christmas, I went to the ophthalmologist. Well, that's a fancy name for an eye doctor. And I have to regularly get tested for my eyes because of diabetes and the possibility of retinopathy, which is really a damage to the retina. And I'm always amazed in these tests that you know, they sit down and you sit and you rest your chin out on this little thing, and they put the camera right up to your face, and they put one patch over the other eye, it's amazing what they can do. They can see behind your eye. They can see everything that's taking place. They can see into almost right into your depths. But one of the exercises that they have you do, and your chin's on there, and you got the patch over your eye, and they have a bright light right in the middle, and they tell you, focus on that light. And so you focus, and then they start saying, don't blink, don't blink, don't blink. Well, that makes me want to blink. And then they said, you can't be distracted, but there's going to be little lights popping up on the screen all over, and Every time you see another light, you have to click the button, but you have to stay focused on what you're doing. You have to stay focused on that bright light right in the very middle. And oh man, it is so hard. And every time you see a light go, the temptation to look over there, the temptation to look there, but to look straight ahead without blinking, to be focused. And I see that for us personally in our spiritual lives, that there are so many distractions and things that come against us, and that I think as we move into this new year, that we want to sharpen our focus on our relationship with God and our friendship and relationship with Jesus. You know, it's almost too like a magnifying glass, where you take the magnifying glass and you just go down. I remember my dad in his later years, he would take the magnifying glass to read the newspaper, and it's like four or five words would just jump out at you and you don't see the rest of the text. And I think it's a little bit like that. So you might be asking the question, why this spiritual disciplines would be the other term for that, or spiritual practices or rhythms of grace or a rule of life. And I feel like right now it's like that study with the ophthalmologist, that we want to begin to look into our souls and see, where are we at? We want to, you know, people can see the outside, they can see the surface, but only you and I know the depths of who we are inside. And I think it's a time for us to begin to establish and reestablish rhythms that will help us focus on who we are and our relationship with God. And honestly, this was something that started with me last March, so 10 months ago. And it's like we have more time, we have less events to attend, there's less sports events to be taking kids to, or me going to watch with my grandkids, or even on TV, there was way less sports events. So we have way more time to be doing stuff like this. And I just feel like this time, moving into the new year, that there's a great need for us as followers of Jesus to be intentional in our walk with Him. You know, over the years, I've read a number of books on different disciplines, spiritual disciplines, and some of the titles, Habits of Grace, Enjoying Jesus Through the Spiritual Disciplines, or Richard Foster, this is quite a famous one, The Celebration of Discipline, or Kent Hughes wrote Disciplines of a Godly Man, Don Whitney, Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life. Most of these I have on my bookshelf. Most of them I've read. You know, Douglas Gregg, he writes about Disciplines of the Holy Spirit. Gordon MacDonald, Ordering Your Private Life. And the last one I've recently been reading is Adele Calhoun's Spiritual Disciplines Handbook. And it seems like it's the most inclusive in this genre of spiritual disciplines. But the reality is we have lots of information, lots of resources about what this looks like. And my heart's desire for us as the church, but also for you as individual followers, is that this season and this time, whether you call it a resolution, or whether you call it, you know, this practice or a rule that you're going to set or whatever it is, that we would develop these rhythms of grace in our life as we follow Jesus. I've asked a number of people a few questions, and I just thought it might be interesting for you to hear, because my heart is that spiritual disciplines are not just for people that are in the priesthood and the pastors, but this thing of rhythms of grace, it's just for ordinary people, me and you. This is something that we can all do and we should all work towards in our lives. And I thought it would be great for you to hear some of these people answer some of the questions. So, you know, we'll put the question up on the screen and you'll hear a few people answering some of these questions.
An intentional activity that requires effort but results in a closer relationship with God.
Regulations, something else I have to do. And it came to me that it's like baking. So when you want to perfect a recipe, you try and you try and you just, like cinnamon buns, and you just get it right, and the dough is soft and fluffy, and you get the sugar and the cinnamon just right, and the bottom is just soft and gooey, and then you take that bite and you just go, oh, I just want more. That's what it's like when you do the disciplines and you develop that relationship. You just want more.
To set in your life habits that you value, the way that you want to live, that you value those things by making time and space to grow in those areas, to be intentional. And I feel like in any relationship, if you don't put in the time, you don't get to truly know that person. And I like to see God as a relationship like that, where I truly get to know Him by being intentional with my time with Him.
Just like a sticky note reminds you every day what you need to get done, I find by getting in routine and having spiritual discipline, it helps remind you how to focus in on God every day.
I feel like the purpose of spiritual disciplines is to set a goal and priority. And that takes practice. So it's a day-to-day thing, and you will get better, and you will learn more, and you will train, kind of like running. You practice and train, and you will see the benefits of spiritual disciplines, and you will hear from God lots. I truly believe that.
Prayer, being still and knowing that He's there.
Worship, both as part of a gathering of believers and as a silent individual experience in a natural outdoor setting.
So for me, the most transforming spiritual practice that I've been doing for the last little while has been along the lines of what we were taught in Freedom Session, where you read a portion of scripture and you go through that section and you mark it up, underline that type of stuff, and then you read it again. And then you pull out a verse that stood out to you. It could stand out with a question, it could stand out something that was powerful, and then you kind of write your thoughts in a journal.
Just making time, forcing myself to make the time.
I would say the spiritual discipline that I struggle with the most is having an accountability partner or person that I really confess my struggles to and check in with. I feel like I can just get lazy about that and not express the areas of weakness in my life that I need prayer and support with. I tend to just want to put my head down and work hard and figure it out on my own.
So for me, to make time and space for God, I actually put an appointment time in my phone for every day. And so some days that doesn't happen, and that's okay. And for the most part it does, and it works. I see that appointment come up, and then I know that I need to spend some time with God, reading His word, or even sometimes it's just as simple as listening to a song.
Again, forcing myself to make the time. When I wake up in the morning, before my feet hit the floor, I pray. When I wake up during the night, which is often, I pray. And before I go to bed, I always read a song and pray.
Sadly, some days it seems like everything becomes a distraction to making time for God. I wish it was only one thing that would distract me, but when life's busy, it seems like everything else becomes a priority.
The overlapping schedules and activities that we commit ourselves to that sweep us through life.
So as I come into our key text this morning, which is Matthew chapter 11, verses 25 to 30, I want to just give you the bit before. Often we find these verses, and I love this verse, and I'm reading it in the Message translation. But before we hear this great passage where, you know, Jesus says, cast your burdens on me, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Before that, he literally is going through a time where he's talking about the judgment for unbelievers will be better than that for the righteous, the Pharisees and the religious people. And so in this passage, right before, in verses 20 to 24, we see that the wise men and the Pharisees rejected Jesus, and the simple people, or sinners, accepted him. And this is in Matthew chapter 15, this is what Jesus says about the righteous and religious people. He says, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce, for they teach man-made ideas as commands from God." The intellects, they had no use for Jesus, but the humble welcomed him. And Jesus is not, when he comes into this next part of the passage, he's not condemning intellectual power or, you know, cleverness. What he's coming against is intellectual pride, where we think we know more, we know better, we don't need this, we've already got this under control. The heart, not the head, is the home of the gospel. Intellect does not shut out the gospel, but pride does. And it's not foolishness that accepts the gospel, it's humility. And Jesus, in this passage that I'm going to read, he spoke to people who were desperately trying to find God, desperately trying to be good, and trying to find it, they discovered that it was impossible. And so after Jesus is talking about this judgment over the religious people and people that rejected him, he abruptly goes into this passage, and this is how it starts in Matthew chapter 11, verse 25 in the Message. Abruptly, Jesus broke into prayer. "Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. You've concealed your ways from sophisticates and know-it-alls, but spelled them out clearly to ordinary people. Yes, Father, that's the way you like to work." Jesus resumed talking to the people, but now tenderly. "The Father has given me all these things to do and say. This is a unique Father-Son operation, coming out of Father and Son intimacies and knowledge. No one knows the Son the way the Father does, nor the Father the way the Son does. But I'm not keeping it to myself. I'm ready to go over it line by line with anyone willing to listen." And then he goes to say this. This passage is the well-known part of the passage. "Are you tired? Are you worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly." There's three things in this passage that Jesus encourages us. He says this, that we would walk and work with Jesus and watch how he does it. Honestly, church, my heart's desire, my passion, my longing, I guess, is that whether we can gather, whatever takes place coming into this new year, however things change, that one thing will be certain about you and I, or you and me, correct English, would be this, that we are pursuing and our relationship with Jesus more than ever. So he says, walk and work with Jesus. He also says this, learn the unforced rhythms of grace. This season, as we move forward in the new year, there are things I believe we can learn, these rhythms that we can learn. And then finally, Jesus says in that passage, keep company with me. Learn to live freely and lightly. Unforced rhythms of grace are more than just our striving, our pushing, and our trying harder. Sometimes we feel like we're trapped on this never-ending treadmill, and it's all our own efforts. We're trying to earn God's forgiveness. We're trying to earn God's approval, and we're trying to earn God's acceptance. But we need to give up on that kind of stuff. And Isaiah actually says, he describes that as our filthy rags, and then with open arms and an open heart, receive his forgiveness. And I also want to say to you that I know we start disciplines and we start these practices, and then we kind of mess up, and then we try again, and then we mess up, or we lose interest. And I want to encourage you to just stop beating yourself up. You know, every one of us has these struggles as we continue to intentionally walk with Jesus. But I would say this to you, when you understand God's grace and forgiveness, you'll understand the difference between obligation and relationship. You know, under the old covenant of the law, right living was done out of an obligation, a religious obligation. Under the new covenant, the new promise with Jesus, it's a covenant of grace. Everything we do is birthed out of an inward motivation that flows directly from a love relationship with Jesus. Jesus invites us to experience the unforced rhythms of grace. You know, in Philippians, Paul writes this, "Therefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure." Dallas Willard, in his book, The Divine Conspiracy, says, "Grace is not opposed to effort, but it is opposed to earning." In other words, we cannot earn our life with God. It's a gift. But we are to make every effort to work out this life with God. Focusing our lives on Jesus is where transformation begins. Gordon MacDonald, in his book, Ordering Your Private World, says this, "It's this private part of life where we know ourselves best of all. This is where self-esteem is forged, where basic decisions about motives, values, and commitments are made, and where we commune with our God. To bring order into our personal lives is to invite God's control in every segment of our lives, that we have that special intimate place where we commune with him through Jesus in a way that no one else can understand." You know, I don't know if you feel like this, but often we hear stories about sinkholes and, you know, people could be just driving along and all of a sudden the road just gives way and there's this big hole. And, you know, I think sometimes our Christian walk is a little bit like that. We feel like, ah, I'm doing great. And then boom, you just fall into this pit and you don't know how you got there and you don't know what did it. It could be fatigue. It could be failure. It could be disillusionment. There's so many things. But all of a sudden, it's just like you feel like something's going to give away. And it feels like we often in that season, we're living two separate lives. We've got our public life. We've got our spiritual life. And it's like, how do we make this all work? Everything's falling out. And I just want to say, I believe the purpose of these spiritual disciplines or these spiritual practices or unforced rhythms of grace are what bring these two lives together, your personal life, your public life, your inward life, your outward life. You know, I don't know if you've ever had this question, how are you doing spiritually? I wish I could say I was growing closer to God, or some people say, I wish I could say I was growing, period. But the response is I'm sort of standing still. I think as we walk through these next couple of months talking about rhythms of grace, that you will begin to see change and transformation as you pursue these practices. You're going to see some amazing things take place in your life. You're not going to be standing still. You won't be stagnant, but you'll be moving forward and you'll be moving deeper into your relationship with Jesus. So I've kind of divided this series up into three sections. One, the first part will be connecting with God, which is literally what are the upward practices we have. And I'm going to talk briefly about one of those just at the very end, but things like, you know, practicing the presence of God, or things like gratitude or prayer and fasting. With that, for example, prayer and fasting, tonight we're starting the first of this week of prayer every night, January 3rd to January 10th at 7:30. I would encourage you, join us online to pray together. You know, God knows no boundaries. The Holy Spirit is with each one of us. And so whether we're online, whether we're together, we can still pray for each other. And you heard it on church news, but I'm really excited. Charlie Sweet's going to join us for a couple of those nights. And I think it's going to be great. He's going to be bringing some prophetic ministry into the church that is super exciting as we go forward in this year. So connecting with God is kind of our upward practice. And Then growing with God is what I would call our inward practice. Things like confession and self-examination and walking through forgiveness in our own lives and reading His Word and spiritual direction and accountability, teachability, or submission and humility. Some of those things that we can build into our own life have practices. And the third area I would say is joining with God, or what I would call outward practices, and that's joining in His mission. Things like hospitality and discipleship and our witness and justice, standing up for issues and things in our own nation. And you know, God intends spiritual disciplines for us. This is not for a separate group of people. This is just for ordinary people. People who have jobs, people who care for children, people who wash dishes, people who mow lawns. It's far more crucial than the mechanics for coming into the reality of the spiritual life. Spiritual disciplines are God's way of planting us deeply into His life. Spiritual disciplines are intended for our good. They're meant to bring the abundance of God. The desire to know and love God should fuel all of these disciplines. I have a bunch of questions I'll keep throwing out this morning, but how do I grow in my love for God? Or how do I grow and express my love for my neighbors? I have this longing to know Jesus. How do I know Jesus more? And I'm hoping that we can take you through that and that you will see some changes and some strengths in your life. It is these spiritual practices, it's these rhythms, these unforced rhythms of grace that open us up to God. Ken Shigematsu, in one of his books, talks about the rule for life. In other words, developing rules, and it's not like, you know, these laws, but it's he uses the term like a trellis. It's like a plant growing on a trellis, and that as we establish these rules of life, we begin to shape what our spiritual life looks like, that we would become intentional in the personal rhythms and the guidelines and the things that shape our days. You know, that you would even create a simple statement of the rhythms that you choose in order to present your bodies. He says it this way, as spiritual act of worship, Romans 12, verses 1. He says, therefore, I urge you, brethren, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, as holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. You would even list some of the practices that actually draw you towards God. Or what are the things that want to get the attention of your life, and how do those distractions, it's like that ophthalmologist test when they were testing my retina, is that you got these little lights going all over and I need to focus on the middle light. That's Jesus, and don't blink. And then when it was all done, they would say, okay, you can blink now. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness. How do you determine the time that you spend with God? What does that all look like? And I was thinking, in all of these questions, I thought of the two blind men as Jesus was leaving Jericho. These two blind men were shouting at Jesus, have mercy on us, have mercy on us. And everybody was shouting them down and said, be quiet, be quiet. And yet Jesus stood still and he called them and he says, what do you want me to do for you? And I thought that's a really good question for each of us to ask as we move into this new year, this new season. What do we want to see Jesus do in our lives? I think that question provokes a response from us. What do you want? As we step into 2021 and we're talking about rhythms of grace, what do you want to see take place in your life? Begin to ask some of those questions. And so the first practice, and this is what we're going to try and do every week, we're going to try and give you some questions, some practices that you can try to develop in your life each week, and we'll post them online. And the first practice is one that I actually started with last March. And, you know, I was kind of, when COVID hit, it was like everything was changed. Rhythms were changed. Time of things were changed. And I just was looking at my own life and thinking, where am I in all of this? And where is my relationship with God? And so I started on an aspect that was it's said this way. Open yourself, or open myself, to God. And the truth is, we become so preoccupied with everything that we have to do that we forget to make time and space for an intimate relationship with God. You know, even as a pastor, I know Tamana and I would say this, that we can get so busy doing things and obviously helping people. Those are all good things. And, you know, we got family things and, you know, we like to go out for dinner. We like to do different things. We can get so busy doing that stuff that we forget that we need to create this space and time for this intimate, deep relationship with God. And so this first practice is making space in our crowded lives to notice and experience the move of the Holy Spirit in your life. We sang at the beginning this morning, there's nothing worth more. Nothing will come close. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. So I'm going to give you two simple practices this morning that you can look at this week. I think it's a great way for us to start this series is just ask yourself some of these questions and say, God, what will it take for me to open up my heart, to open up my life, to open up myself to you? And one of the words is contemplation, which literally is saying to yourself, I need to wake up to the Spirit, wake up to what God is doing, and experience the moments of God every day. I love Acts 17:27. Luke writes this, his purpose was for the nations to seek after God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him, though he is not far from any of us. For in him we live and move and have our being or exist. And as some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. So contemplation is just taking those times to recognize those moments of God, recognize what is God speaking into your life. And you know, when you're busy and when you're distracted with all of the other things, it's really hard to do that. And I'm encouraging you this week, as we start the new year, make some space to just look at your life and say, God, I notice you here in my life and I see you here. The other thing I would encourage you this week is self-examination. In other words, listening and noticing when God shows up in your daily life. You know, we have expressions like wake up and smell the coffee, or slow down and smell the roses, you know, and just little things to think of. What am I most grateful for today? What did I experience, or when did I experience God's love today? Or what was the most life-giving thing in my day today? Or what was the most draining? And you know, in Philippians, Paul writes this, I pray that your love will overflow more and more and that you will keep on growing in knowledge and understanding. For I want you to understand what really matters so that you may live a pure and blameless lives until the day of Christ's return. And that little phrase, for I want you to understand what really matters. And I think in this season, just to take those two things, contemplation and self-examination, and let's look and say, okay, God, where do I notice you? Am I noticing you? Where are these spaces where I'm taking that time? I think of a Simon and Garfunkel song that says, slow down, you move too fast. I think even as we head into this new year, that you can find these moments to slow down and to acknowledge and recognize, to notice those moments when God is active in your life, and then give thanks to him. I love what Tim Keller says when it comes to spiritual disciplines. He says this, when it comes to spiritual disciplines, don't be a sprinter, be a long distance runner. Come on, this is, you know, it's kind of like some of these New Year's resolutions. Man, we're going to go and we're going to run and we're going to, let's do this systematically. Let's do this a step at a time, because over time, that you begin to see some of these practices developed in your life as we walk through this series, Unforced Rhythms of Grace, and that you begin to see God active and working in your life. I just want to finish with one last passage, and then I want to pray for us, because I believe, again, moving into a new year, that even the word new, you know, in Isaiah chapter 43, he says, behold, I do a new thing. Well, we have that opportunity. It's so great that God is like that with us, that we have these new moments where we can start fresh and we can start new. And in Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, I often use this passage in marriage, but really the reality is that the angel is giving John a revelation of seven churches. And he talks about the good things and he talks about the bad things. And he's talking to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2. And he starts in verse 2, I know all the things that you do. I've seen your hard work. I've seen your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You've examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You've discovered they are liars. You've patiently suffered for me without quitting. But I have this one complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. And I thought, you know, as we start this new year, that you would, I think the King James says it this way, that you would remember your first love. Remember, go back and remember your story. When did you first decide to follow Jesus? When did you first open up your heart and your life to Jesus? And I think this time, the newness of this season, this can be a time of repentance. This can be time, you know, for things maybe in your life you say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for some of these things that I've been doing. And God, help me to make more time for you. Or forgiveness. You know, I think this is a season. And I really would encourage you, church. Maybe there's people you have to forgive. Maybe you need to forgive yourself. But just to have the freedom and not that pressure and the tension of knowing that you're struggling here, you're struggling there, that you just accept the forgiveness of Jesus. But also, forgive those who have offended you. And, you know, the other thing is, well, acceptance. And then the other thing I would encourage as we move into 2021, that you would restore relationships. I know this is a really tough one and really hard, but as you move forward and as you open up your heart to God, and as you begin to develop some of these practices, these unforced rhythms of grace, that you would just begin to see relationships in your life from a different perspective, with the love of God that he has in your heart. And so I want to pray for that as the worship team's coming. And the song we're going to finish with this morning is There's Nothing Else. I'm sorry when I've just been going through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where you started. Remember your first love. I open up my heart to you. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, I just say this on behalf of all of us. We love you. And we have a longing in our hearts to know you more, to walk and work with you, to keep company with you, to experience all of the freedoms that come by allowing you to take control of our lives. And Father, I pray for us as a church in this season that people would experience a repentance. They would experience just a new sense of forgiveness. And I pray for the restoration of family and relationships across the board, God. I just pray for that and believe for that. And in these moments, as the worship team is coming, I want to encourage you. Maybe ask yourself some of those questions. How can I grow in God this year? What practices will help me get to know him more? And most of all, how can I open up my heart to God? God bless you. We're so excited to see you at prayer these next few nights. But I just pray that in this season, you draw closer and closer to Jesus Christ. So I bless you. I bless all of you. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
summary, when I forgot that you're enough, take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you, 'cause I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna say, every part.
love you, Jesus.